Thank you, colleagues. We will now proceed with the division on Amendment 9, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. The result of the vote on Amendment number 9 in the name of Mark Griffin is yes 52, no 65. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. We move to Group 2, Levels of Risk. I call Amendment 10 in the name of Mark Griffin, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Mark Griffin to move Amendment 10 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move Amendment 10 in my name. All the amendments in this group, aside from Amendment number 42, attempt to make it clear that issues raised through the single building assessment must link directly to a life critical risk only. The amendments intend to replace the current references that, to risks that are directly or indirectly created or exacerbated by a building's external wall cladding system, with broader references to any risks that are created or exacerbated by that system. All the amendments seek to change the language in the bill so that it clarifies that issues that are raised through the single building assessment must link directly to life-critical risk. At stage two, the Minister indicated that he wouldn't support this approach. He said that not being clear on the level of risk may narrow the focus of the single building assessment to risks that are directly attributed to the cladding system alone, with the result that secondary or indirect risks that impact on the risk to life could potentially be overlooked. Ultimately, such a narrowing of the assessment could have the effect of leaving remediated buildings at a higher risk level post-remediation than the bill currently allows for. The Minister didn't engage any further in these amendments, so I assume the Government still see no merit in taking these further. The Government's approach to the content and the scope of the single building assessment is far too vague. It seeks to take as much detail over what is required as possible off the face of the bill and leave it to regulations to finalise while it waits for the conclusion of the SBA task and finish group. Now, the policy memorandum states that engagement with partners suggests that there would be a clear benefit in providing further technical detail and guidance on the single buildings assessment. It's essential that all parties that will be impacted by it have full clarity at the outset about what a single building assessment is, its specification, what it looks like and what standards it's assessing. The Minister's assessment at stage three goes some way towards that, but residents and developers deserve more clarity about the details of the SBA. The Minister assures us that the outcomes of the task and finish group will be finalised and published by July 2024. But in practice, Presiding Officer, that means that we are debating the merits of an assessment, the key focus of this bill, without being aware of those key details. These amendments seek to add clarity to some of the aspects of the assessment, ensuring that the actions outlined by the assessment must be focused on those most pressing issues and may be a matter of life and death to residents. On Amendment 42, this amendment seeks to clarify the definitions on the face of the bill. The committee report stated that the single building assessment is the foundation of the cladding assurance register. However, with a binary process that doesn't recognise tolerable risk, there is the potential to include buildings within the cladding remediation programme that are fundamentally safe, thereby exacerbating financial and practical issues for those living in those buildings. The committee recommended that the concept of tolerable or medium risk is incorporated into assessments. Leaving a definition of tolerable risk out means that the bill means that most developments over 11 metres will automatically default to being high risk, making matters worse for homeowners, even if there are no life-critical issues requiring remediation. This amendment seeks to clarify the situation, providing detail and context to the concept of tolerable risk in the cladding assurance register. It's welcome that the Government has agreed that tolerable risk will form part of the single building assessment process instead of the initial process to have binary designations of safe or unsafe. The Minister disagreed with that amendment at stage two, stating that tolerable risk will not be assessed in that way in the SBA. He stated that after all the risks have been identified, the SBA will state which of those risks should be addressed and how, in order to bring the risk as a whole that's posed to human life down to a tolerable level. But the bill doesn't do this. It doesn't require a ranking of the risk and the degrees of nuance. As such, there is no way to assess whether each risk is tolerable. This bill is silent regarding situations following a single building assessment where a building is ascribed a tolerable risk or amber, and regarding what that means for the future management of those buildings. Again, those considering this bill, those residents, those developers, have very little detail on its workings and are being expected to take assurance from government that unpublished findings will address their concerns before this bill passes stage three. The government has had 7 years to consider how to make this work. It's not unreasonable for Parliament to expect more detail on how the assessment will affect developers and residents going forward, and that should be on the face of the bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I call the Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I suppose just a point before I touch on amendments. I've met with Mr Griffin on a number of occasions and offered at the committee as well to meet him to discuss these, and that offer goes ahead, you know, once the bill is passed, as the cladding programme moves forward. But I want to first of all speak to Mark Griffin's amendments in the group that relate to the language used in the bill. This covers the majority of the amendments in this group, with the exception of Amendment 42, to which I'll return. Mark Griffin's amendments in this group mirror those that he lodged at Stage 2. They seek to amend the language of the bill specifically in relation to the risk to human life. And speaking to his amendments at stage two, Mark Griffin clarified that the purpose of his amendments was to ensure that the issues are raised through the single building assessment must link directly to life-critical risk. In my own remarks, I stated that I could not support the amendments as the current wording in the bill is crucial to its purpose, and to change it could increase the risk to owners and occupiers in affected areas. I remain of that view that the current language in the bill should be kept. This is because it is clear that the risks to be addressed may either be directly caused by the cladding system itself or indirectly influenced by it. If the bill does not make that clear, then the risk is that the focus of the single building assessment is narrowed to the risks that are directly attributed to the cladding system alone, with the risk that secondary or indirect risks that impact on the risk to life could potentially be overlooked. One important point I want to stress as well is obviously the change from a risk to any risk as grammatically and legally unnecessary. These changes could have the effect of leaving occupiers of remediated buildings at higher risk post-remediation than the bill currently allows. Now, I ask Mark Griffin not to move these amendments, but if he does, then I ask members to reject them. I said I would come back to Amendment 42, and now turning to Amendment 42, also in the name obviously of Mark Griffin, in which he also mirrors a Stage 2 amendment, which was ultimately not moved. Mark Griffin clarified that this amendment was to counter a binary high-low risk assessment. However, I have repeatedly put on record that the remediation work will bring buildings to a tolerable risk of standard. This is the approach on which the SBE standards are based, and that is the right place for discussion of tolerable risk. It is not appropriate for a bill to contain reference to tolerable risk without any further context or explanation. Now, in addition, at stage two, I pointed out unintended practical effects of this amendment. Specifically, its effect would be to require that the single building assessment sets out whether each risk identified during the assessment process is tolerable. However, this is not how tolerable risk will be assessed in the SBA process. The SBA will identify all risks and will state which of those risks should be addressed and how, in order to bring the risk posed to human life as a whole down to a tolerable level. As such, there will not be a way to assess whether each risk is tolerable. Tolerable risk must be assessed in the round, taking into account the risks as a whole identified in relation to a building and how these risks may be mitigated. Therefore, the way this amendment is expressed would not allow an SBA to be conducted in the way it is required to be. Furthermore, members will be aware that the SBA standards are currently in development, and in my view, this will be the best place to deal with the questions of how tolerable risk are defined, and obviously that is in discussions with developers themselves. I therefore invite Mark Griffin not to move this amendment and ask members to reject it if it is moved. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I call on Mark Griffin to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 10. Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In pressing Amendment 10, I make the point again that the amendments in this group and the previous group are on a continuous theme of providing more details of what is, as committee and as the government have set out, the key concept within this legislation, which is the single building assessment. We are leaving all of that detail to further discussion and publication post stage three and agreeing this legislation. I think, given that we are 7 years down the line, that the government have missed the opportunity to give much more clarity to residents and developers as to the process of assessment and remediation, and it's one that we're seeking to rectify in this group and previous groups. And like I say, we'll press Amendment 10.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their vote now. The vote is now closed. The result of the vote on Amendment number 10 in the name of Mark Griffin is yes 47, no 68. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 11 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I then would call Amendment 12 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. And I then call Amendment 13 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I now call Amendment 14 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 9. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Moved.
Moved. The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their vote now. The vote is now closed. The result of the vote on Amendment number 14 in the name of Mark Griffin is yes 48, no 67. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 15 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I now call Amendment 16 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. We now turn to Group 3, Definitions, Powers to Determine or Modify Meanings and Minor and Technical Amendments. I call Amendment 1 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 4, 5, 6, 7, 47 and Amendment 8. I would point out that if Amendment 4 is not agreed to, I cannot call Amendments 5 and 6, and that if Amendment 5 is not agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 6 by way of preemptions. I call on the Minister to move Amendment 1 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Minister.
President Officer, formally moved. President Officer, this group mainly consists of a number of minor and technical amendments. Taking the amendments in my name first, Amendment 1 makes a minor change for consistency of language with other sections of the bill, namely references to a building rather than the building. Amendments 4, 5 and 6 have the effect of moving the definition of additional work assessment into section of its own. The substance of the definition itself is not changed. Amendments 7 and 8 in this group are technical but important amendments that will allow the legislation to adapt to learning from the Cladding remediation programme about the types and configurations of buildings that are affected by unsafe cladding. This is important because there are a wide variety of buildings and configuration of buildings that the programme will affect, and these amendments introduce additional functionality to respond to operational circumstances. Turning to the detail of the amendments, there is already power by regulation to change the type of buildings that a single building assessment or SBA can be carried out in relation to. Amendment 7 simply allows Scottish Ministers by regulation to clarify the type of building that an SBA applies to should the need arise. Amendment 8 allows the Scottish Minister to determine any question that arises to whether any particular configuration of structures joined together constitute one building. For example, if an 11-metre plus wholly commercial building is attached to a smaller wholly residential building, both with cladding, there may be a need to determine that the whole structure constitutes one building. But there may be other examples where it would be safer and more informative for the Cladding Assurance Register to treat two conjoined structures as separate buildings. This amendment allows ministers to deal sensibly with situations of this kind. Turning to Amendment 47 in the name of Mark Griffin, I do not support this amendment because it would take away flexibility in future to assess, remediate and place on the Cladding Assurance Register buildings below 11 metres that might be affected by unsafe cladding. Our risk-based approach has consistently outlined that the current scope of the programme is buildings 11 metres and over in height, based on a risk-based assessment of capability to fight a fire reflecting each of the ground-mounted water jets and use of the specialist height appliances. The SBA is for buildings 11 metres and over. The bill is reflective of this scope. However, at the point that the future ministers want to change the scope, then it would be possible, subject to due consideration through appropriate regulations. We do not want to limit that flexibility by stating in this current bill. I therefore reject this amendment and invite members to do the same.
Thank you, Minister. I call on Mark Griffin to speak to Amendment 47 and other amendments in the group. Mr Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Section 26 of the bill confers power on the Scottish Ministers to modify Section 25 so as to change the types of buildings in relation to which a single building assessment may be carried out. That includes power to amend the last three of these criteria. So, for example, regulations could specify, in relation to the height criterion, a height lower than 11 metres. Use of this regulation-making power could therefore expand or restrict the buildings which will be able to be entered into the Cladding Assurance Register in future. The bill provides a specific definition of buildings that fall within scope. That includes a requirement on their height, but it allows it to be amended by regulations at a future date, including to add buildings of heights lower than 11 metres. For consistency, the amendment sought to prevent the government from being able to alter the height specifications of the buildings that will fall under the legislation. House builders believe that, for consistency, this height specification definition should align with the Building Scotland Amendment Regulations 22, which state not including rooftop plant areas or any plant rooms at the height of 11 metres or more above the ground. The Minister argued that the SBA is for buildings over 11 metres and the bill is reflective of that scope, and if ministers want to change the scope in the future, it would be subject to due consideration through appropriate regulations, and again cited that he did not want to limit the flexibility by stating the height in the bill. I don't think that Parliament should grant ministers the ability to make those changes which could bring countless number of homes and properties into the programme. Again, this position makes for a bill that is subject to regulation and uncertainty after it is passed. Developers and residents will find it difficult to act on the obligations within the bill if it's not consistent with existing legislation and if height requirements can change in the future.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I call on the Minister to wind up. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've already set out, my amendments in this group are minor and technical in nature, but nonetheless important to ensure that we deliver as effective a piece of legislation as possible. I therefore ask all members to support these. I've also set out my position on Mark Griffin's Amendment 47, but let me reiterate that our risk-based approach has determined that this bill and associated cladding remediation programme are focused on buildings 11 metres and over in height. It is prudent, however, to allow for a future scenario where that scope could change, subject, of course, to due consideration, my apologies, and scrutiny through regulations. This amendment would remove the flexibility entirely. As such, I must reject this amendment and ask all members to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that Amendment number 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. We now turn to Group 4, Personal Emergency Evacuation Plans. I call Amendment 17 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, grouped with Amendments 18 and 22. And I call Pam Duncan-Glancy to move Amendment 17 and speak to all amendments in the group. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I speak to all the amendments in this group in my name. In the Grenfell tragedy, 41% of disabled people in the Grenfell tragedy died. The amendments that I have in this group aim to ensure that that doesn't happen again. I know from bitter experience, as do many members across this chamber, that disabled people are too often forgotten and that they tend to pay the highest price, none higher than the disabled people in the Grenfell disaster. In almost all walks of life, disabled people can be left out by default, and we have to fix that by design, which is what my amendments to this legislation attempt to do. The disproportionate number of disabled people that died in Grenfell is a tragic example of how disabled people are forgotten and the impact that can happen. I'm committed to ensuring that in my time in this place, in every way that we can, in every way that I can, disabled people are never forgotten. So Amendment 18 in my name states that disabled occupiers of a building in which remediation works are required are entitled to request that a personal evacuation plan is carried out. It sets out that Scottish ministers would be responsible for ensuring that these PEEPs are conducted and that they will only run from the point that remediation works are identified as being required until the point that the cladding assurance register is updated to show that the remediation works have been completed. Amendment 17 provides that remediation works should only commence once those plans are in place. And recognising that some detailed work will be needed to be done on this, including with residents and indeed the fire service, I've also lodged Amendment 22 in my name. Amendment 22 offers the Government and others in the Chamber an alternative approach to a similar aim. It gives Scottish Ministers the powers to introduce regulations that create the Personal Emergency Evacuation Plan to ensure that disabled people, if they require, have that plan to get out and safely evacuate a dangerous building under the legislation. As with the other amendments, 17 and 18, I only intend for these personal evacuation plans to remain in place until cladding remediation works are registered as being completed. And that is why, in addition to the general regulations relating to the provisions of PEEPs, Amendment 22 also ensures that any PEEP which is arranged would expire upon the cladding assurance register being updated to indicate the remediation works have been completed. This was necessary in order to bring these amendments into scope for this particular bill. There is a wider question about the evacuation of disabled people in buildings during emergencies that I hope we can get to at some point in this parliamentary term to address in general, but in specifically to this piece of legislation, in order that it could be brought in to be within scope. I did add into the amendment that it would cease to apply after the building has been fixed. So, in short, if members can't agree to Amendments 17 and 18, which requires ministers to take the action specifically, I would like them to support Amendment 22, which would ensure that disabled people's safety is a key consideration in the legislation, as Grenfell proved that it really must be. Amendment 22 would keep the door open, working with the Government and the Fire Service and disabled people's organisations and residents in these buildings to create a strong system of evacuation plans, with the safety of disabled people being at its core. Crucially, Deputy Presiding Officer, any of these amendments also require that the Government make it known that disabled people have this right should they pass. That particular point was because the issue of data sharing was brought up in stage two. And so the amendments require that disabled people themselves self-select and ask that they are given support to identify the evacuation process for them. And so I hope that I have addressed all of the concerns that the Government and others have raised, and that the Chamber will be minded to support these crucial amendments today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Clancy. I call Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. I'd like to speak briefly in support of Pam Duncan-Glancy's Amendment 22, which provides, as we have heard, for personal emergency evacuation plans. Again, as we heard from Pam Duncan-Glancy, 41% of the people who died in the Grenfell tragedy had a disability and needed support to evacuate, but the fire service didn't know that. So I am speaking in support of this amendment. I won't rehearse the detail of the amendment, but I think it's a well-designed and thoughtful amendment, and I seek assurance that the Scottish Government will accept this amendment for what I think is an essential part of the remediation programme.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. And I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. I'm fully supportive of these amendments. Pam Duncan-Glancy made a powerful case for them at stage two. She didn't press them at that point because the minister said he would work with her. I think he has. So we've arrived at this point, because if you can just imagine, if you were disabled, most of us can't imagine that, but if you were disabled and you were in a block where there's a fire, how are you going to get out unless you're on the ground floor? First of all, somebody has to know that there are disabled people in a block. So that needs to be addressed. That is, perhaps that's up to the disabled person themselves to alert somebody. But there needs to be some sort of scheme in place. I am very, very sympathetic to what Pam Duncan-Glancy said about not just limiting this to blocks with cladding. I think it's actually is something we should look at beyond blocks with cladding and have personal evacuation plans in for disabled people, full stop. So fully supportive of the ambition behind these amendments, and I hope that Parliament can support them.
Thank you, Mr Simpson, and I call the Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm most grateful to Pam Duncan-Glancy for raising this important issue and other comments that have obviously been made this afternoon in that particular area. And I appreciate the time that she has devoted to working collaboratively with myself and also the Minister for Community Safety in respect of fire safety issues for her constituents and obviously for disabled people. I know in part Ms Duncan-Glancy's questions were prompted by the Grenfell experience and the disproportionate impact upon disabled people there. I wholeheartedly share her concern. I can assure her that the work is taking place across the government and in partnership with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and other stakeholders to ensure the safest built environment for all residents. Following stage two, I have been corresponding and met with Ms Duncan-Glancy on the topic on a number of occasions. I have been very open with her in my view that PEEPs as proposed in her amendments may not deliver the comfort or assurances that Ms Duncan-Glancy is seeking through these amendments. PEEPs were a significant feature of the Grenfell inquiry as a result of the high proportion of residents with disabilities who lost their lives in the fire. Following phase one of the inquiry, the Scottish Government's Grenfell Inquiry Fire Safety Working Group concluded, however, that PEEPs could not be feasibly implemented in all residential buildings in Scotland. Despite the failings at Grenfell, evidence shows that the likelihood of a fire spreading beyond a flat or a compartment on fire is minimum, and such the stay-put policy is likely to be employed in the buildings in interest to this bill. Should the fire rescue and service decide that the evacuation of the building is required, there would be responsible for this, evacuating those at greatest risk initially. Existing robust fire safety measures will apply, and there is a comprehensive fire safety guidance from the Scottish Government for fire assessment in high-rise buildings and in special residential circumstances. I firmly believe that the best way to safeguard all residents of buildings affected by unsafe cladding is to ensure that remediation works can proceed at pace following the single building assessment. We must focus on bringing buildings to a tolerable risk level for all as quickly as possible. Now, while I know that it is not Pam Duncan-Glancy's intention, Amendments 17 and 18 could prevent remediation works in a building from proceeding at all if anyone within the building requested a PEEP until that document was prepared. The impact and effect of this could be risks to human life remaining longer than necessary. I am also conscious that there is no qualification of the meaning of premises within these amendments, which could leave them open to interpretation and create further delays and confusion. This provision therefore hinders the speedy remediation of buildings, which would benefit every occupant, including disabled people, whereas a PEEP might have little real benefit in the context of cladding remediations. I would draw members' attention to amendments we will consider on today on engagement with owners and occupiers, again prompted by discussion at stage two with Pam Duncan-Glancy and Miles Briggs. Of particular relevance, Amendment 46 relates to post-assessment engagement, specifically on remediation work, and will provide an opportunity for wider engagement and discussion ahead of and during remediation works. I can commit here today that for the buildings which Scottish Ministers are responsible for arranging the remediation of, we will use this engagement to specifically consider with residents with disabilities the information, guidance that they need to feel safe and secure in their homes throughout the remediation process. Where a building has been remediated by a party other than Scottish Ministers, I will use my best endeavours to ensure members of the Responsible Developer Scheme engage with owners and occupiers in a similar fashion. Whilst I do not support the intention behind Amendments 17 and 18, I remain concerned that the practical application of PEEPs may not be feasible in the operational situations we are discussing today. I would, however, greatly welcome the opportunity to work with Ms Duncan-Glancy to ensure our operational cladding remediation programme best meets the needs of disabled people, including the potential role of PEEPs, and we have mentioned that on a number of occasions. For this reason, I am supportive of our Amendment 22 that ministers may make regulations regarding the development and provision of PEEPs for disabled occupiers of buildings to which an SBA applies, looking at such like policy development, but also engaging with the likes of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and obviously working with Pam Duncan-Glancy and the groups that she works with very closely in that regard. So this is an important issue, and one which would benefit from fuller consideration, including operational scoping of the potential use of PEEPs. I'm happy to commit here today to work not only with Ms Duncan-Glancy. Yep.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister to give way. And on that point, can he give an indication of the timescale that he's looking at with regards to that reach-out discussion consultation and then coming back with the proposals?
Minister.
Yeah, just on that particular, Mr Duncan Glancy and I met this morning and talked about that. We'd be looking to arrange that as soon as possible. It's an incredibly important part of the work that we need to do going ahead. So I'll be reaching out to Mr Duncan Glancy in the next few days just on that particular point. So I'm happy to commit here today to not only work with Mr Duncan Glancy, but also with disabled people and other relevant stakeholders to seek to collectively deliver an effective solution that does not limit our ability to take forward remediation without delay in all cases where risks to human life related to the external wall cladding system are identified. In this context, it would be helpful to have the option of regulations if required. I would therefore ask that Ms Duncan Glancy does not move Amendment 17 or 18 and instead works with me to take forward the approach set out in Amendment 22.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Pam Duncan Glancy to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 17.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank the Minister for his engagement between Stage 2 and Stage 3. I'd also like to thank colleagues across the Chamber for their support for these amendments. I've previously said, and I've had discussions with the Minister to say that I would be content with the approach set out in Amendment 22, given that a lot of this would be put forward in regulation. Although I have to say I'm a little concerned at some of the statements that have just been made around the limitations of what might be involved in that. I hadn't been fully aware that those limitations would be really part of what those regulations would look at. A bit concerned that the Minister mentions that there could be limitations in terms of a PEEP being in place. And the timescales for that. Also a bit concerned about the worries that the Minister has said around being able to the practicability of putting in place these evacuation plans. When we had our discussions, my understanding was that the detail needed to be worked out in regulation, not that some of these things would be off the table. So I'd welcome an intervention from the Minister just now, if he would care to do so, to reassure me. Otherwise, it would be, I think, in my interest to press Amendments 17, 18 and 22. If the Minister wanted to intervene, I would be keen to take that.
Minister?
Yeah, thanks, Presiding Officer. And the Member will know that I wrote to her on the issue. Very recent, nothing's changed from that, and I think the discussions we kind of had, there is nothing off the table, and I think the main thing in terms of what we're looking at is the discussions, the much broader discussions, for example, with yourself, with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, so it's not going in with any limitations. I think we wrote to yourself on that particular point, so you've got my reassurance in that area.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Okay, I thank the Minister for that reassurance, and members across the Chamber may not have seen that correspondence, but suffice to say it's a bit more detailed and a bit more reassuring than what we've heard on the record in the previous few minutes. So on that basis, I will move forward with Amendment 22, but not 17 and 18.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. So just to clarify, Ms Duncan Glancy seeks to withdraw Amendment 17. And I need to ask whether any member objects to that. Does any member object? No member objects. Amendment 17 is therefore withdrawn. Ms Duncan Glancy also seeks to So now call Amendment 18 in the name of Ms Duncan Glancy, already debated with Amendment 17, and Pam Duncan Glancy to move or not move.
On the basis of the commitments that I've had and that I previously had in writing, I will not move.
Not moved. And I now call Amendment 19 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. And I now call Amendment 20 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I now call Amendment 21 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. And I now call Amendment 22 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, already debated with Amendment 17. Pam Duncan Glancy to move or not move?
Moved.
Moved. The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is agreed. We now turn to Group 5, Appeals Against Arrangement of Remediation Works. I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendment 3, and I call, on the Minister to move Amendment 2 and to speak to both amendments in the group. Minister.
Thanks, President Officer. Formally moved. Amendments 2 and 3 have the effect of removing subsection 5 of section 10 and introducing a new subsection 2A to 2C, making alternative provision. As originally drafted, the aim of this subsection was to ensure that appeals, which could hold up life-critical remediation work, were dealt with quickly. However, concerns were raised by stakeholders representing the courts that it may not be practical to determine the appeal within 21 days, and so the provision as drafted could lead to unintended consequences. This amendment therefore responds to concerns by changing the requirement to determine the appeal within 21 days to a requirement that the court hold a meeting and hold a hearing within 21 days. The court would that have the option either to determine the appeal immediately or to continue the appeal to a later date. In deciding whether to continue the appeal and when, the Sheriff must have regard to all the circumstances of the case, including the effect of the continuation of the appeal on the carrying out of potentially life-critical work. This amendment therefore strikes the right balance in ensuring that appeals which may hold up potential life-critical work are determined quickly, while giving the court sufficient flexibility to deal with the appeal appropriately depending on the circumstances. I ask members to support these amendments.
Thank you, Minister. I note that no other members have pressed their request to speak button, and so I would ask the Minister whether he has anything further that he wishes to add in wind-up.
Nothing to add.
Nothing to add. Therefore, I can go to put the question. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 2. Minister to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is agreed. We now turn to Group 6 on independent oversight. I call Amendment 23 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, grouped with Amendment 29. And I call on Pam Duncan Glancy to move Amendment 23 and to speak to both amendments in the group. Ms Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'll speak to the amendment in my name in this group. Amendment 23 in my name introduces an independent reviewer for the single building assessment. The independent reviewer would be responsible for approving the arrangement of the SBA and the SBA report, and the arrangement of any work that is to be carried out as identified in the report. This amendment also allows Scottish ministers to make regulation concerning the expertise and reimbursement of the reviewer, and any such regulation will be subject to the affirmative procedure. Amendment 29 in my name amends Section 20 of the Bill as it presently stands to ensure that Responsible Developer Scheme includes detail on independent oversight of the development and delivery of the single building assessment. Again, this is to ensure that any responsible developer responsible for conducting an SBA has sufficient independent oversight to ensure the SBA covers all bases. In discussions with residents, and in particular at some developments in Glasgow and the region I represent, they made it clear to me that they are seriously concerned about the potential of a conflict of interest, especially in the circumstances where the people responsible for fixing the building could have built it in the first place and identify the remediation needed. Residents have made it clear that they would like independent scrutiny of the SBA process in the bill, and I think it's an important part of this to avoid any conflict of interest. The experiences of residents in the past have soured relations between parties involved, and so it's no wonder that there is deep distrust, and I'm hopeful that the bill and these amendments could remedy that. In any event, I believe that there has to be sufficient protections in the bill to ensure that those responsible for identifying and fixing issues are held to account, and ensure that there is an added layer of protection against a conflict of interest. I hope the Minister will support these amendments, and if he cannot, then I would invite him to put on record today why he believes the bill is already equipped to mitigate any conflict of interest. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy, and I now call the Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Ms Duncan Glancy for these amendments and for the engagement I have had with her on them. Amendment 23 seeks to introduce the role of an independent viewer to bring a degree of independent assurance to the assessment and remediation process, whereby these activities are instructed by the Scottish Ministers. Amendment 29 seeks to require that similar provision about independent oversight of delivery and development of the SBAs is made in the regulations that create the Responsible Developers Scheme. As I've discussed with Ms Duncan Glancy, I don't agree with the principle of ensuring appropriate checks and balances are in place to protect owners and residents and to limit any potential conflict of interest arising by remediating parties. I do, however, believe that there are sufficient measures already in the bill that Ms Duncan Glancy mentioned about, which I would like to put on record today. The single building assessment standard itself is being developed by independent specialist fire safety engineers, with this document also going through an industry-wide review process. This is due to be finalised this month. Whether a single building assessment is instructed by Scottish ministers or a developer, it must be carried out in accordance with these standards and by a person authorised by Scottish ministers. This ensures not only a consistent approach to assessment, but that it also always completed by a suitably qualified and competent individual. For example, a fire engineer with professional registration. The outcome of this assessment in all cases will be a single building assessment report, which will also be peer reviewed. Additionally, work can only be considered complete when the cladding assurance register is updated and works have been completed to the satisfaction of Scottish ministers. Work is underway now to develop robust compliance and assurance processes to support this within the cladding remediation programme. I should also clarify that remediation works will have the normal protections of building certification. If the works require a building warrant, this will need to be applied for and meet current building regulations. Once the works have been completed, they will be subject to verification of their completion certificate by a verifier in accordance with the Building Scotland Act 2003. Lastly, I want to remind members that we must avoid the unnecessary delays in progressing with both assessment and remediation, which I believe this amendment would introduce. An independent review before arranging an SBA, producing the SBA report and works commencing would draw out the timetable for works being done and potentially hold up conducting urgent remediation work on immediate risks to human life as set out at Section 7 of the Bill. I don't believe that the independent reviewer is necessary in light of the measures I have just outlined. I do, however, thank Ms Duncan Glancy for raising what is an important point, and we have agreed again to continue to discuss discussions beyond the Bill as we move towards the remediation programme and building up on that. Based on the assurances that have been offered here today, I ask her not to move this amendment, keep on discussing this with me, and ask members to reject if moved. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Pam Duncan Glancy to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 23.
I thank the Minister for that response, and he'll know, as I do, that members or people who live in these buildings are really, really keen that there is a process in place to ensure that there is no conflict of interest between the people who built the building, the people who decide what should be fixed in it, and then the people who fix it. I am, however, assured by some of the comments that the Minister has made on the record there, and I'm content at this stage not to move those amendments. And I would also remind the Minister of the commitments that he made to residents when he met them over a week ago now, to make sure that their voice will never again be forgotten in this process, that they can be assured of a conflict of interest being mitigated, and that when determining the responsible developer scheme, that the Minister will make sure that this is a key part of it, that addressing any conflict of interest is a key part of it. On the basis of the reassurance that I've sought and that I think I've heard today, I won't press those amendments. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Pam Duncan Glancy seeks to withdraw Amendment 23. Does any member object? No member objects. Amendment 23 is therefore withdrawn. We now turn to Group 7, Engagement with Owners and Occupiers. I call Amendment 24 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, grouped with Amendments 25, 26 and 32. I call on Pam Duncan Glancy to move Amendment 26 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Ms Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And this is in a very similar vein to the points that were just raised. And I think together with some of the assurances we've had, but also specifically in this amendment, we could, I hope, bring owner-occupier voice to this process much more to the fore. Amendment 24 in my name would ensure there is engagement with owners and occupiers of dangerous buildings prior to the commencement of the single building assessment. It would provide that ministers with responsibility to use their best endeavours to ensure engagement is undertaken, so that owners and occupiers can be informed the assessment will be conducted, and so they have the opportunity to ask questions about it. And again, I think that will help with their concerns around conflict. Amendment 24 would ensure that owners and occupiers of these buildings can remain informed, something that residents have told me has not been the case in the past. From having waking watches imposed on them without any further information, to being told that they had to decant their cars from the car park without any information on where they should be decanted to, owners and occupiers, particularly in the Glasgow region but across Scotland, have had no opportunity to adequately have their voices heard. This amendment intends to address that. Owners and occupiers of these buildings have the most important voices, and so I think it is crucial that they're heard. I'm also pleased to see Amendment 25 and 26 in Miles Briggs' name, which will ensure owners and occupiers are kept informed about the results of any single building assessment that is carried out, and to ensure they have the opportunity to ask questions and find out more about what's happening in and at their homes, with the amendments also ensuring owners and occupiers are consulted in regard to any remediation that is required to be undertaken. Owner and occupier voice has to be added to this bill. If lessons to this date have taught us little, they must have taught us that. For too long, their point of view has not been taken into consideration at the forefront, and they've been pushed from pillar to post. This amendment and the amendments in these groups offer a strong opportunity, I think, to put that right, to give them a voice and make the cladding remediation process as transparent and engaging with those people as it possibly can be. And so I urge members to support these amendments. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Duncan-Clancy. I now call Miles Briggs to speak to Amendment 25 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Members who represent constituents who live in the 105 buildings and developments who are affected will have heard from homeowners and residents that communications to date have not been adequate on the Government's cladding remediation programme. People whose properties are affected by unsafe cladding must be given access to the outcome of the single building assessment, and there must be clear and meaningful engagement with them ahead of any remediation works taking place on, at the end of the day, their homes. The Minister has acknowledged that communications must improve, and I welcome this, as well as his commitment to ensure this is urgently addressed beyond the passage of this bill. And I also thank him for his cooperation on Amendments 25 and 26, which build on Amendment 2, which I proposed at Stage 2. Amendment 25 seeks to ensure ministers inform occupiers and owners of the outcome of this building, single building assessment. And Amendment 26 will require ministers to ensure further with them ahead of any remediation works taking place, except in urgent circumstances where the duty to engage is limited to what can be practicable. Taken together with Pam Duncan-Glancy's Amendment 24, ministers will therefore be required to ensure clear and consistent communications throughout a building's journey on the cladding remediation programme from assessment to remediation. I hope these amendments will be welcomed by members from across the chamber. I know certainly for people affected they have been desperate to see communications put on the face of this bill, so very much hope that this will certainly improve the experience of many of my constituents. And I move amendments 25, 26 and support all the other amendments in this group.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. I now call on the Minister to speak to Amendment 32 and other amendments in the group. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I shall begin my remarks by thanking both Pam Duncan-Glancy and Miles Briggs for their cooperation regarding the amendments that they have lodged in this group. The amendments reflect the Stage 1 process and evidence that the committee heard on the importance of engagement with owners and occupiers. As well, Presiding Officer, the positive nature of the Stage 2 process and the commitment to work together to develop these amendments. It is this, with this in mind, that the Government will be able to support these amendments, but I shall comment briefly on the matters that they raise. Starting with Amendment 24, in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, on pre-SBA engagement, I have previously updated the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee that we were working on an improved communications protocol and acknowledge the point that Miles Briggs made on that, and we need to do better in that regard. Ensuring that we engage fully with owners and residents ahead of ministers, arranging for a single building assessment to be carried out will form part of this. I am therefore comfortable to commit Scottish ministers to meet the duty to communicate in these terms and would ask members to support this amendment. Turning to Amendments 25 and 26, in the name of Miles Briggs, on post-ASB engagement with owners and residents, I can similarly note that our improved communication programme protocols aims to improve engagement with owners and residents where we are remediating their buildings, as I touched on before. And I'm again comfortable to commit Scottish ministers to meet these duties contained in these amendments. Finally, in Amendment 32, in my own name, this provides that the regulations creating the Responsible Developer Scheme can place a duty on ministers to use best endeavours to ensure members of the RDS scheme engage with owners and occupiers before an SBA is carried out and during remediation work. I will also seek to secure this outcome through contracts connected to the RDS scheme. This approach allows us to demonstrate our commitment to ensuring developers communicate and engage with residents and buildings that they are remediating. I also ask members to support this amendment.
Thank you, Minister. And I call Graeme Simpson.
Thank you once again. I want to support all the amendments in this group. I made the point at Stage 2 that communications is absolutely vital and that it shouldn't just be with people who own flats. It needs to be with the people who actually live in a block. And as members will know, I did live in a block where I was evacuated during a fire. And after I first moved in, I became aware at night, actually after a fire in the underground car park, of some men, they were men, wandering around at night in orange jackets. They formed part of a waking watch I only discovered this when I asked one of them what they're actually doing. So after moving in as a tenant, nobody told me there was a waking watch. I think that anyone who lives in a block should be informed of these things, not just owners, but actual residents as well. So I think these are really good amendments, and I think they would potentially go some other way to tackling that issue. I would just caution Miles Briggs. I'm always uneasy about language such as use their best endeavours and so far as practicable. That allows government to sort of wriggle off the hook a bit. But we'll see where that goes. But I think I do think this minister is serious about this. So if he's serious about it and if he's kept in place, he has been so far, then perhaps we'll be able to deliver on it together. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. And I call on Pam Duncan Glancy to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 24.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I think that members have spoken quite clearly about the importance of engaging with both owners and occupiers, as my colleague Graeme Simpson has just highlighted. And one of the reasons that I think that is incredibly important is exactly the point he just made about the men who appeared in buildings. And I know that owners and occupiers had contacted me, some women in buildings who were surprised to see some men as part of a waking watch. So they're there that day without any prior notice. So in terms of safety, not just for the building, but also security and peace of mind, I think these amendments are absolutely essential. And so I would urge members to support the amendments in this group. And I move and press Amendment 24 in my name.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. The question is that Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. I now call Amendment 25 in the name of Miles Briggs. Already debated with Amendment 24. Miles Briggs, to move or not move? Thank you. The question is that Amendment 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. I now call Amendment 26 in the name of Miles Briggs. Already debated with Amendment 24. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. I now call Amendment 27 in the name of Mark Griffin. Already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I call Amendment 28 in the name of Mark Griffin. Already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I now call Amendment 29 in the name of Pam Duncan Glancy, already debated with Amendment 23. Pam Duncan Glancy, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. We now turn to Group 8, Responsible Developer Scheme. I call Amendment 30 in the name of Miles Briggs, grouped with Amendments 31, 33, 36, 37 and 38. And I call on Miles Briggs to move Amendment 30 and to speak to all the amendments in the group.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open this group focused on adding clarity to the provisions in the bill relating to future regulations on the Responsible Developers Scheme. The lack of detail on the face of the bill on this scheme has caused some concern for stakeholders, and whilst I welcome the Minister's commitment to consult ahead of any regulations being brought forward, I do believe there is an opportunity to strengthen the bill with these amendments. Amendment 30 would add provisions allowing processes on decision-making on membership of the Responsible Developer Scheme to be added to any regulations establishing the scheme. Given the potential consequences on developers being refused membership or having this withdrawn, transparency of decision-making is crucial, and that is underpinning the intentions of my amendments here. Amendments 36, 37 and 38 all offer assurances to those who may become members of the Responsible Developer Scheme that there will be a right of an appeal against any decisions that may impact on them, such as membership of the scheme being refused or withdrawn, or a member being added to the prohibited developers list. These decisions could have significant impact on businesses and developers, and it's of course right that there should be a right of appeal to this. My Amendment 31 and 33 are similar to the probing amendments I brought at Stage 2 and would require ministers to set eligibility according to developers' varying sizes and situations. In England and Wales, care has been taken to consider the exposure of SME builders. And as things stand, Scotland's SME developers lack protection within the bill and certainty about the future direction of travel which this bill may bring. Should they be subject to the building safety levy, the suggestions that small developers could be at risk of two new forms of additional taxation and charges. I took on board the Minister's remarks at stage two and have adapted these amendments to take into account the sentiments also in the Minister's letter to committee, with these amendments providing the aim of requiring ministers to set regulations in relation to the size and circumstances of developers. For example, it was suggested that applying specific turnover of these businesses on the face of the bill would reduce the flexibility of the regulations prior to work being done to consult on what these regulations should contain. Now, we know that we are not meeting building targets across Scotland, and we know that our SME sector, which is so important to delivering the homes we need in rural and island communities, is already under significant pressure. These amendments, therefore, I believe, provide the right balance, and I move all the amendments in this group in my name.
Thank you, Ms. Briggs. I call on the Minister. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On Amendment 30, Miles Briggs, Amendment 30 states that the RDS regulations may specifically set out the decision-making process in respect of membership. For example, loss of membership is also our view that the amendment is acceptable and wholly and usefully sets out further detail on what we would expect to be contained in RDS regulations. On Amendments 36, 37 and 38, these amendments set out the RDS regulations must provide for a right of appeal in relation to decisions to refuse to allow a person to become a member of the RDS scheme, cease that membership or add a developer to prohibited developers. The scheme, we are happy to accept this amendment, which usually ensures developers will be able to appeal decisions that may affect their ability to conduct business. I am therefore pleased to be able to support Mr Briggs' Amendments 30, 36, 37 and 38. On Amendment 31, Amendments 31 and 33 relate to the Responsible Developers Scheme. Amendment 31 seeks to amend Section 20 of the Bill and enable the scheme to make allowances for different developers, particularly regarding their size. Amendment 33 has a similar aim in seeking to limit the scope of the Responsible Developer Scheme to developers with a turnover above as yet to be an unspecified amount. Now, I want to touch on Amendment 31. I would like to make it clear that Sections 23 and 24 of the Bill already allow ministers to make provisions in regulations that are specified in Miles Briggs' amendment. The Responsible Developer Scheme will also be able to make provision for different developers with regards to the size or other characteristics of a developer. Now, I've had a number of discussions, as he knows, with a number of SMEs, and will continue to do so. I do understand what Miles Briggs is trying to achieve here, as it's been an important issue for him all along, and indeed other committee members, as well as stakeholders throughout the bill process. Given there is a clear consensus on the need to consider specifically the size of developers, and in fact I see this as a key component of the consultation I've already committed to ahead of any regulations being brought on the RDS, I am content to support this amendment. I want to touch now on Amendment 33. Amendment 33 is something else that I know Miles Briggs feels very strongly about, and again I know this has been an important issue during the bill process. His amendment seeks to limit the scope of the Responsible Developer Scheme to developers with an annual turnover above an amount to be specified in regulations. I would like to put on record that I acknowledge the importance of getting this issue right, as the Government is cognisant of the potential impact on developers, including SMEs. Throughout the bill process, the Government has been clear it is engaged in ongoing discussions with a wide range of developers, just as I mentioned previously around about the SMEs, on the detail of the Scottish Safer Buildings Remediation Contract. The intention is to closely align the contract and the Responsible Developers Scheme. A key theme in these discussions is a developer's ability to pay. Now, a task and finish group it was established on this issue, which is working closely with developers and Homes for Scotland on a number of issues, on financial thresholds, on the contribution of smaller developers and arrangements for firms that may find themselves in financial distress. This also remains the issue to whether turnover is the most appropriate measure meant to use. In England, it's operating profit and the question of how group companies are treated. These are important questions that connect directly to the wording of Amendment 33. Overall, I would stress we are still developing the policy approach on these issues, and we would like to consult on the approach through the Responsible Developer Scheme with stakeholders. I am pleased that developers are engaging with us on this topic, and I am keen to conclude these discussions ahead of a formal consultation on the Responsible Developer Scheme, aligning the two as closely as possible. Of course, I'm happy to continue working with Miles Briggs. I've worked with him during the process and will continue to work with him after the bill process as well. But I am concerned that this amendment would restrict the possibility, and I ask Miles Briggs not to move his Amendment 33 and for members to reject it if it is moved. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Miles Briggs to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 30.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I welcome that the Minister has moved on Amendment 31. I think it was important. There are still many questions around SMEs' impacts, especially SMEs who are operating in England and Scotland and where profit will be taken into account for this. So, content with what the Minister has said, I do think in terms of the development of the guidance, and I know there's different working groups taking that work forward, it's really important that that detail is provided earlier, and whether or not there's a scrutiny role the Local Government Committee can have with regards to that, I think is also important so we can make sure we get this right and limit any potential for small businesses in Scotland to go under. Basically, I think that's one of the major concerns which has been expressed to us, and I'll move all amendments in this group apart from Amendment 33.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. Okay. I now call Amendment 31 in the name of Miles Briggs. Already debated with Amendment 30. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Moved.
Moved. The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 32 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 24. Minister, to move formally.
Moved formally.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 33 in the name of Miles Briggs, already debated with Amendment 30. Miles Briggs, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I call Amendment 34 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. I call Amendment 35 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. I call Amendments 36, 37 and 38, all in the name of Miles Briggs and all previously debated. And I invite Miles Briggs to move Amendments 36 to 38 en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. I would ask whether any member objects to a single question being put on Amendments 36 to 38. No member objects. The question is that Amendments 36 to 38 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is agreed. We turn now to Group 9, Progress Reports. I call Amendment 39 in the name of Graeme Simpson, grouped with Amendments 40, 48 and 49. And I call on Graeme Simpson to move Amendment 39 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Mr. Simpson.
Thank you, and members will be delighted to know this is the final group today. We've been making swift progress, and perhaps that's down to the way the Minister has worked collaboratively across different parties. A lesson for the First Minister, perhaps.
I'm very pleased about that sedentary contribution from the First Minister. Mr. Simpson, please continue.
Yes. Well, if you didn't hear it, the First Minister said he's here to learn, and he can learn from the Housing Minister. So I'm bringing for who's now suitably embarrassed. So these amendments, 39, 40, 48 and 49, relate to duties on the Scottish Ministers to report on progress with the cladding remediation programme. These amendments build on the amendments which I and Miles Briggs lodged at Stage 2, but which were ultimately not moved. Amendment 39 requires the Scottish Ministers to report on the progress with arranging and carrying out single building assessments and on the progress of remediation work. The reports may also include such other information as the Scottish Ministers consider appropriate. Amendment 40 provides further detail on what the reports must contain. This includes information about the number of buildings in relation to which a single building assessment and remediation work is in progress, whether this is being arranged by Scottish Ministers or by developers who are members of a responsible developers scheme. There's also a requirement to provide quantitative information about changes to the cladding assurance register such as the number of times an entry is amended to show completion of work, which will provide a very useful indication of the overall activity on cladding remediation. The first reporting period is the period of 18 months after the section comes into force, and subsequent reports must be prepared for each year after that. The bill requires that there be 10 reporting periods in total, but there is the option by regulation to increase this number. Amendment 49 allows subsection 4 of Amendment 39 to be amended by regulation, so the actual date of commencement is referred to. And Amendment 48 provides that the regulations provided for in these provisions are subject to the negative procedure. These amendments will ensure that there is open and transparent information on the progress of remediation, which is so crucially important to the owners and occupiers of buildings affected by unsafe cladding. And I move Amendment 39, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson, and I call the Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank Mr. Simpson for bringing forward these amendments 39 and 40, which place supporting duties on the Scottish Ministers, and amendments 40 and 49, which set out technical matters. I am, of course, in favour of open and transparent government, which these amendments support. These duties focus on the progress of the cladding remediation programme, including the progress by developers who will be members of the Responsible Developer Scheme. Therefore, the positive impact of the programme on owners and occupiers whose buildings are affected by unsafe cladding is at the heart of the reporting duties. Presiding Officer, I fully support these amendments.
Thank you, Minister. I call Graeme Simpson to wind up. Press and withdraw Amendment 39. Mr. Simpson.
Nothing to add.
Thank you. The question is, therefore, that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 40 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 39. Graeme Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. I call Amendment 41 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
That is not moved. I call Amendment 42 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a vote, and members should cast their votes now. And the vote is now closed. Point of order, Christine Graham.
I couldn't connect, and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Douglas Lumsden.
Not connect, but I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I'll make sure that is recorded. Point of order, Jeremy Balfour.
Yes, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. I'll make sure that is recorded also. And the result of the vote on amendment number 42 in the name of Mark Griffin is yes 45, no 66. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 43 in the name of Mark Griffin. Already debated with amendment 9. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
That is not moved. I call amendment 44 in the name of Mark Griffin. Already debated with amendment 9. Mark Griffin to move or not move?
Not moved.
That is not moved. I call Amendment 4 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. I point out that if Amendment 4 is not agreed to, I cannot call Amendments 5 and 6. Minister, to move formally.
Yep, moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 45 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
That is not moved. I call Amendment 46 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 10. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Not moved.
It's not moved. I call Amendment 5 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Again, I point out that if Amendment 5 is not agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move forward.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 7 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 1. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. I call Amendment 47 in the name of Mark Griffin, already debated with Amendment 1. Mark Griffin, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. God, we're almost there. And the vote is now closed. And the result of the vote on amendment number 47 in the name of Mark Griffin is yes 47, no 66. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. Call amendment 8 in the name of the Minister, already debated with amendment 1. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament has agreed. Call Amendment 48 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 39. Graeme Simpson, to move or not move?
Moved.
Question is that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is agreed. I call Amendment 49 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 39. Graeme Simpson, to move or not move?
Moved.
Good. Question is that Amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed, and that ends consideration of amendments. As members will be aware, at this point in proceedings, the Presiding Officer is required under standing orders to decide whether or not, in her view, any provision of the Bill relates to a protected subject matter, that is, whether it modifies the electoral system and franchise for Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this Bill, in the Presiding Officer's view, no provision of the Housing, Cladding, Remediation Scotland Bill relates to a protected subject matter. Therefore, the Bill does not require a supermajority to be passed at Stage 3. The next item of business is a debate on Motion 131. 90 in the name of Paul McLennan, Housing, Cladding, Remediation Scotland Bill. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Paul McLennan to speak to and move the motion. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and formally moved. I'm delighted to open this Stage 3 debate on the Housing, Cladding, Remediation Scotland Bill. I'm sure we will all recall events of the 14th of June 2017. The Grenfell Tower tragedy provided absolute clarity as to why building safety is so important, and we must not forget this. Our responsibility now, and the primary driver of this bill and the wider cladding remediation programme, is to safeguard homeowners and residents of buildings with potentially unsafe cladding and to ensure that a similar event is never, ever allowed to happen again. Colleagues across this chamber have worked hard on this bill for that very purpose, to make buildings with potentially unsafe cladding safer and to ensure that our approach to cladding remediation is informed by those who will be affected by the cladding remediation process. I'd like to thank the convener, Ariane Burgess, and all members of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee for their thorough consideration of the complex issues involved. And even though we're discussing the bill today, Presiding Officer, I've engaged with the committee and will continue to engage with members as we move through the programme itself. This bill has benefited greatly from the positive engagement of opposition spokespeople and other members. The engagement I have had from members across the chamber has been open and constructive, and I very much welcome that. It's my strong belief that this bill and other key elements of the programme, including the finalisation of the single building assessment specification and the development of the Scottish Safer Buildings Developer Remediation Contract, lay the foundations needed to drive forward our remediation programme at pace. I want to just come back and obviously remind members about the key points of this bill. The single building assessment. Centrally, the bill creates powers for ministers to arrange for single building assessments to be undertaken to assess risks in buildings within the scope of the cladding remediation programme. It also defines the legal meaning of a single building assessment, or SBA, and allows ministers to specify the standards to which such an assessment should be undertaken. And Pam Duncan and Glenson and I and Co-Cab Stewart met with residents of Lansfield Quay, I think, a number of weeks ago. And that was really important in terms of what they've come through. And so that was actually seeing people having to live with that every single day in that regard. So centrally, as I said, it allows us to arrange for single building assessments to be undertaken. It also defines the legal meaning of a single building assessment, or SBA, and again, it allows us to specify the standards to which such an assessment should be undertaken. Focus on a crucial aspect of the SBA process. I have already confirmed to this chamber that the fire risk appraisal of external walls, a central element of each SBA, will be based on PAS 9980, tailored to a Scottish context. This is a critical enabler in setting the standard and propelling the pace for the programme, and is in line with recommendations from the committee's consideration of the bill. On remediation itself, the bill creates powers for ministers to arrange for necessary remediation work identified through an SBA that's to be undertaken. This will include urgent cases where the risk is immediate, as well as the power to require occupants to evacuate buildings should the level risk necessitate this. Both the power to carry out a single building assessment and the powers of remediation in the bill can be utilised without the consent of owners, where appropriate notice has been given, or, if the work is urgent, where notice has been given as permitted by the circumstances. This is not a step to be taken lightly, but real-life experience from the pilot phase of our remediation programme leaves no doubt that it is an essential provision if progress is to be made. On the cladding assurance register, as I've mentioned, safeguarding owners and residents must remain our primary driver. I'm also alert, however, to the consequential negative impacts which can currently arise in relation to the buying, selling, remortgaging and insuring of properties with potentially unsafe cladding. The bill requires ministers to establish a cladding assurance register containing information on buildings which may have been through a single building assessment and any required remediation. This register will be key to ensuring that an accurate record of remediation works undertaken is maintained, so that those with an interest, such as lenders and insurers, can understand and take assurance from the scope of works undertaken in each building. Lastly, on the Responsible Developer Scheme, Presiding Officer, the bill will give ministers the powers to establish, through secondary legislation, a Responsible Developer Scheme. Though this will enable developers to participate fully in the remediation of any of their buildings. I have been pleased to work closely with both Homes for Scotland and developers and look forward to continuing to do so, as well as taking forward a consultation ahead of any regulations been brought forward to establish this scheme. In conclusion, I want to iterate my thanks to all who have contributed to the development of the Housing Cladding Remediation Scheme and engaged so constructively and in consideration of its Parliament. And I want to pay a special consideration to my colleague, Cocab Stewart, I think is in the chamber, about the work she's carried out and other members as well in terms of that. It doesn't impact on every single MSP in here, but when it does impact, it impacts on a large-scale basis. So many thanks to the members who have worked with in terms of this over the number of months in this position. I think the key thing is as well, the bill itself is one part of the process. We know we've got lots to do in terms of the remediation programme. So I've talked about the bill enabling faster delivery of the cladding remediation programme, addressing barriers experienced today, allowing us to deliver that step change in pace that is required to best serve those homeowners and residents affected by potentially unsafe cladding. I move the motion in my name. Thanks, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. I now call Miles Briggs, around 6 minutes. Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking the Parliament's clerks for their assistance with amendments for stage three of the bill. And I also want to start by paying tribute and thanking the Housing Minister for the constructive way he's approached cross-party work on this bill. It's been very important for us to take that forward. Last Monday, I met with a group of residents who live in an orphan development here in the capital to discuss the cladding bill. And what they hope is the start now of the end of what they have called a living hell. Because the stress which residents have faced and the information vacuum which they have had to live in has been unacceptable, especially when you consider that these are our constituents living in properties that have been labelled as potentially containing cladding, which poses a threat to life. They were absolutely clear that they want a solution and they want that as soon as possible. Because for too many people, their lives have been put on hold as they find out if the cladding on their buildings is safe or not and what works need to be undertaken to allow them to just move on with their lives. As one resident said, this whole situation has been really upsetting. For many of us, the total lack of work that sees us remain stuck in our properties, deemed fire risks, unable to sell or move on with our lives. Deputy Presiding Officer, I sincerely hope that the passing of the bill today will be the start of a solutions-based approach by the government to deliver the outcomes needed to let people move on with their lives. This cannot just be a process. This has to be about delivering the outcomes. And the Scottish Government must take forward this bill at speed and commission the surveying of buildings and the managed delivery of solutions at pace. And I'd also like to make an appeal for the buildings which have been part of the initial pilot, which are orphan buildings, to be given an early focus. We know that they were in terms of the pilot schemes, but I hope ministers will acknowledge that they have been let down, and with a potential solution already outlined to many residents, there must be an early focus on the government's commissioning of surveys and works for these buildings. And I've offered my constituents that I would write to the Minister to see if he would meet with them to discuss how that can be taken forward, not just for their development, but the other pilot projects. As I stated at stage one and stage two of the bill, I was determined to improve the rights of residents and the rights they have to be kept informed at not only the surveying work taking place, but then what remediation work will take place and how that will impact on their homes. And I hope the amendments in my name included now in the bill will give residents the reporting mechanisms which will inform them of what is happening, when remediation work will take place. Good lines of communication is critically important. I hope the poor experiences residents have seen will now change. As the Minister stated in his letter to MSPs, the collaborative approach regarding the bill will extend beyond its parliamentary passage, and I really do welcome that. The Minister returning to Parliament with further updates on the programme and progress being made is hugely important. I hope Parliament and the Local Government Housing Committee will take an active role at making sure that is progressed. The bill has created a progress and framework, but it's critical that we now see all these delivered as outcomes. As the Local Government Committee report stated, progress by the Scottish Government some 7 years on has been concerningly slow. That is in sharp contrast with England, where more than two-fifths now of buildings have had work on either started or completed, with 1,608 buildings in their scope compared to 105. That is why it's understandable that industry witnesses who gave evidence to committee expressed significant frustration at the slow progress we've seen in Scotland and the lack of leadership to date. But I hope the Minister is about to change that. Although the bill is often technical in nature, as with all framework bills, the devil is in the detail, and I do hope that both the guidance and ministerial direction will be properly scrutinised, especially to look at impacts not only on our constituents but also on SMEs as well. During stage one debate, it was clear from the evidence and discussions that we had as a local government housing committee that many buildings will need ongoing management and often bespoke factoring solutions, and a number of points were outlined during the debate earlier. I hope we will now see details of how this will be taken forward. Although many of these issues are out of the scope of the bill, they are important, and I hope ministers will look to update Parliament on how that will be taken forward. Members have mentioned, my colleague Graeme Simpson, for example, mentioned electric cars, and that was raised with us as a committee on several occasions, and concerns over the management of electric cars and bikes is something we need to take seriously. In a letter the Minister sent to me dated 7th of May, he stated that the government's approach to purpose-built accommodation for students in the HMO sector, as well as care homes and hotels and hospitals, was not in the scope of this bill, but he was content at the safeguards in place for them. Now, I hope that the Housing Minister will agree to update Parliament going forward on these buildings and the potential for publishing data around any remediation work which is already taking place and how the guidance might be developed to include these sectors in the future from the amendments which have been accepted. For example, in Pam Duncan Glancy's name, I think can provide that opportunity for better safeguarding for disabled people in these developments and others. And I think it's actually presented Parliament with an opportunity to really look at how do we evacuate all buildings in Scotland, especially vulnerable people in hospitals, care homes and disabled people in all properties. And that's something I'm sure colleagues will want to visit as well as a committee. To conclude, Scottish Conservatives will support the bill at decision time tonight. We do so with reservations in relation to the government's limited progress today. That has to change. The reporting duties in the bill and the role Parliament now has to challenge ministers on the delivery of outcomes on this bill, I think, has improved. Above all, though, I hope the Scottish Government will now give the leadership and priority to the expanded team who will take forward this work within the Scottish Government. That is critically important that we deliver. We have 2 years left in this Parliament. I certainly hope by the end of that, the 105 homes, all our constituents living in these homes, will have had these surveys taken place, will know that work will be paid and taken forward to make their homes safe. And above all, we can make sure that Scotland does never see a Grenfell tragedy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. I now call Mark Griffin. Around 5 minutes, Mr Griffin.
Thank you, President Officer. I'd like to thank members of the Bill team and the Minister for making themselves available to my Labour colleagues and I during the passage of the Bill. I also want to thank the committee clerks and fellow members for their work in drafting the Stage 1 report on cladding remediation. And I also appreciate the time and effort of everyone who has contributed to this Bill as it has made it through the committee stages and subsequently to this chamber. Now, as with all bills, as elected members, we must be satisfied that legislation put before us is necessary, that it improves outcomes for those affected, and that it makes people's lives safer and better. In this case, though, we also have to ask ourselves whether the bill, if passed, will help prevent the tragedy of Grenfell happening again. Because, horrifyingly, Grenfell was not a one-off freak occurrence. The losses of Milan in 2021 and of Valencia earlier this year show that until we remove dangerous cladding from our buildings, we continue to run the risk of more fires and more bereaved families mourning their loved ones. Now, in my view, for this bill to pass the test that I set out, it must get dangerous cladding off of buildings more quickly than has been the case in Scotland up to now. My amendments were drafted in that context, seeking to streamline the process of entering buildings onto the register providing assurances to people on the types of action that had been carried out on buildings to remove cladding, and to clarify some of the terms employed in the bill to help developers know when action should be taken. I want to commend the work of my colleague Pam Duncan Glancy in our efforts to ensure that voices of residents are part of the process and that disabled people's requirements are not ignored. I recognise the Minister's efforts to engage with members through the process of the legislation and appreciate his assurance that he would use every tool available to him to handle the crisis in cladding in Scotland. That's welcome, but people have been waiting in properties that they couldn't insure, remortgage or sell, never mind the worry and the stress of another Grenfell tragedy. They've been waiting in that situation for 7 years now. But we know removing dangerous cladding from buildings is complex. It's been the subject of working groups, regulation standards, primary and secondary regulation legislation in the UK and in Scotland. But underneath the noise, the politics, the meetings and the endless promises, we mustn't forget that 7 years is far too long to wait for action for the vast majority of affected buildings. Now, I don't think that this bill will slow down the process of removing cladding, and I recognise the efforts made by colleagues to ensure that the Government provides clarity and transparency on the way it claims the bill will speed up the process. Now, as amended, the bill does serve its purpose, but I believe that my amendments and those of my colleagues would have improved it. But I am still concerned that so much of the detail of the bill is left to secondary legislation. Now, this seems to be symptomatic of the Government's approach across many bills that we've seen, particularly in this session of Parliament, which seems to be to give Parliament the bare bones of a law to agree on in principle and then to promise to deliver the detail at some later point. Now, Presiding Officer, that stifles proper consideration of policy and can't replace debate on the detail of proposals. Now, we will support the passage of the bill at decision time. We believe the bill to be a welcome and overdue step to remove unsafe cladding from buildings. It will start to clarify the role of government and developers and key aspects of regulations which will be essential for remediation and removal in the future. But however, Presiding Officer, much still needs to be done. It needs to be done at pace to ensure that Scotland catches up with the rest of the UK in removing the threat of combustible cladding from people's homes. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Griffin. I now call Ariane Burgess, around 4 minutes. Ms Burgess.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's stated ambition for the bill is to accelerate the progress of the cladding remediation programme, and it's good to see that the committee's work served to unearth a number of issues and help bottom them out, and I wanted to highlight a few of them. On the single building assessment, during committee evidence sessions, concerns were raised about the lack of a specification on what an SBA would consist of. PAS 9980, which is a code of practice published by the British Standards Institute for the specific appraisal of the fire risk of external wall construction and cladding on existing blocks of flats, was brought to our attention. The committee heard from witnesses about its greater nuance and effectiveness in assessing properties and the importance of harmonising the SBA with it. And witnesses also highlighted the clarity that it provides. So it was good to see that the Scottish Government took this on board, and at stage two indicated that it intends to use PSA 9980. I trust that with the bill in place, it will provide the clarity needed for the Scottish Government and developers to move at pace to resolve the cladding issue. On the lack of qualified people, one area that remains of concern, which is not clear to me legislation can fix, is the lack of people qualified to carry out the SPAs and the remedial work. The committee was consistently presented with a picture of skill shortages in the key sectors essential to delivering the bill's ambitions. In the absence of a course in Scotland to train fire engineers to fill that void, it's not immediately clear how this obstacle to acceleration of the remediation programme will be overcome. The slow progress in the number of qualified surveyors emerging from the RICS training course is also concerning, as are the challenges for existing fire engineers in obtaining professional indemnity insurance. And on the register of the makeup of a building, going forward, and not necessarily restricted to the issues this bill addresses, was the idea of a register of what buildings are made of. This came up during work on this bill, but has come up again and again during discussions at the committee on RAC, damp and mould, and building safety and quality in general. And I think this is certainly something that would be good to see the Scottish Government taking on board and exploring more deeply. The challenge that we face in Scotland for people qualified to carry out the single building assessment and the remedial work isn't going to be resolved by this single bill. But having this legislation will provide certainty for professionals of ongoing work and signal the priority being placed by this Parliament on the safety of buildings. This bill is urgently a needed first step to finally get the remediation programme properly underway, and the Scottish Greens will support the bill at decision time. The introduction of standardised single building assessment and a public cladding assurance register are critical measures that will provide clarity and reassurance. But now there can be no more excuses, no more delays. It is time for that decisive action.
Thank you, Ms Gorgeous. I now call Willie Rennie again, around 4 minutes. Mr Rennie.
Yeah, I want to thank members for the efforts that they've made in successfully piloting this bill through the Parliament, to the staff, to the clerks, to the bill team, and to the Minister's approach, because I know he's got a constructive approach to these matters. But whatever the precise mechanism, what people in homes affected by safety issues associated with cladding want to know is when something practical, tangible, physical works will actually be done. Because there's been a huge amount of talk since Grenfell, and it's worth reminding us that it's 7 years' worth of talk, and it was 4 years before the Scottish Government launched the single building assessment, when the then Minister described it at the time as consistent and robust, and it was fulfilling our commitment. Now, that was 3 years ago. It was another year later when the Scottish Government said that it was the next big step, and we've heard about this being the first step. There's been lots of steps, but very little actual, practical, tangible works that make a difference. Later that year, we heard about priority action. The following year, it was an absolute priority. And here we are today with similar rhetoric about how important this bill is. Yet if this process over the last few years was as robust, consistent, and such a big step, then further legislation in the form of this bill perhaps should not have been required. But the reality is that around 1% of the identified buildings in Scotland have had work completed, whereas in England, the figure is 20%, and for the buildings which work has been started, the figure is 42%. So the Minister will forgive people affected by potentially dangerous cladding for being a tad sceptical of the hyperbole that has peppered this whole process. This is not some idle anxiety either. These delays have real-world consequences to people's lives. Sales have been put on hold. House values have dropped. The insurance premiums have gone up. The lives of those people have been left in limbo. And I know some of them personally, and I know directly how much it's affected them, the stress that it's caused, the anxiety that has been felt day in, day out during their quieter periods, but also amongst friends and relatives. There are so many unanswered questions still. We've heard some of them this afternoon. I've still not heard a satisfactory answer as to why the government did not identify much earlier that the tenure process and conditions in Scotland would be a factor. Why did it think that encouragement would simply be enough to get everybody in line in Scotland? Why was that felt the appropriate way rather than a degree of compulsion that comes with this bill? Now, we support the ability to identify and remediate risks through the Responsible Developer Scheme. We support the bill as a whole, but there are still other questions around about, will the councils, who will play a critical role in this process, have sufficient funds to carry out the work? Will there be enough money at a time of great financial stress? And Ariane Burgess quite rightly talked about the shortage of qualified professionals to handle the significant demand in the work that will be required. So I'd be grateful if the Minister could give an update on that in his summing up. And will there be enough homes for people to decant to if that's what's required? And what update, again, can the Minister provide on that? And then, finally, the most important aspect is timescales. When will the powers be commenced? When will the work be done? When does the Minister envisage all homes being judged safe? Now, I don't want the Minister, and I know he's very good at cooperation and a constructive approach, but I don't want the Minister to tell me he's had lots of meetings, because meetings don't solve problems. What solves problems is the practical, tangible work that requires to be done. So I would hope the Minister could give us some deadlines that we can hold this government to account for and we can hold councils to account for, because that's what people want to hear. They've had enough of talk. They just want the action.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. We now move to the open debate. I call first Willie Coffey to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Around 4 minutes. Mr Coffey.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I want to pay tribute to all of my colleagues, my committee members and other colleagues who helped steer and shape the Cladding Remediation Bill through its evidence stages to get to where we are now. Hopefully, a bill that will make our buildings safer from the risk and rapid spread of fire. I want to also acknowledge the role that COCAB Stewart played as a backbencher, with her tireless pursuit of cladding issues on behalf of her constituents in Glasgow Kelvin, and her contribution is greatly appreciated. Grenfell is our marker for the emergence of this bill, and the tragedy there in 2017, which killed 72 people, was the awful event that has led us to review and update our legislation here in Scotland. But in 1999, Presiding Officer, 25 years ago this June, we had a tower block fire at Garnet Court in Irvine, which killed one person. And the important decision taken then was that all cladding in Scotland used in high-rise dwellings had to be non-combustible. It must have been one of the earliest and important decisions taken in the Scottish Parliament when it reconvened 25 years ago, leading to the Building Scotland Act in 2003. It meant that no local authority or housing association high-rises in Scotland had that same cladding material as Grenfell. This cladding remediation bill in front of us today will allow us to assess and act to remediate unsafe cladding. It's got three key purposes that have been considered in great depth by the committee and shared by other members. The single building assessment will align with the industry standard PAS 9980 to ensure consistency right across Scotland. Ministers will be able to instruct works identified as necessary by these building assessments, giving much sought-after assurance to any affected residents. Secondly, it creates the Cladding Assurance Register, which will contain a list of those buildings which have been through the single building assessment process and will show all required remediation that has been completed. Early entry on that register has also been agreed by the Minister at the request of the industry, and this was an important point shared by many people concerned about mortgage lending and insurance issues. And thirdly, it introduces the Responsible Developer Scheme, the purpose of which is to encourage developers to contribute to the remediation of buildings with which they are associated. Developers who do not join the scheme may face certain consequences relating to their ability to carry out future developments. I'm really pleased, Presiding Officer, to note that many of the amendments pursued by colleagues throughout the progress of the bill have been accepted by the Minister. Miles Briggs' amendments on better engagement and communication with owners, the outcomes of the SBA process, and a number of other issues related to the Responsible Developer Scheme were agreed. My colleague Graeme Simpson, also on the important matter of progress reporting, setting out the progress with the SBAs and the remediation programme, the contents of these reports and the timescales attached to them too. And lastly, Pam Duncan Glancy, on her amendments 22 and 24 about the important issues about emergency evacuation planning were all accepted. I have to say this was done in an extremely constructive way, and colleagues have worked hard to have these amendments included and strengthen the bill, in my opinion, as a result. A closing point, perhaps, Presiding Officer, that's quite a lot of the evidence we heard focused on wider fire safety issues, most of which have been around for a while, but are not really within the scope of this particular bill. But I understand they will be taken forward by the government, as I understand it's part of a wider consideration of fire issues in Scotland. Finally, Presiding Officer, the passing of this bill in 2024 will further strengthen Scotland's approach to fire safety in our high-rise buildings that may have dangerous cladding. Protecting the lives and providing assurance to people whose livelihoods are invested in these buildings will be enhanced if we pass the bill at decision time today. And once again, I thank all colleagues for their contribution to this important matter, and I look forward to it passing today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Coffey. I now call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Richard Leonard. Around 4 minutes, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also add my congratulations to the committee, to the minister, to the government for getting the bill to where it is today. I think the bill is better today than it was at the start of the process, and I think that is an achievement by all members of the committee and by the minister himself. But I think this is very much the start of the journey rather than the end of the journey. And I was interested in Mr Coffey's remarks, Deputy Presiding Officer, because if we go back to the last session, Andy Whiteman, who did a lot of work on this behind the scenes, brought together Scottish Government, brought together the lawyers, the surveyors, the insurance. And the issues that Mr Coffey addressed in his speech were highlighted about 5 years ago, that these were the key issues that had to be addressed. And I think there is a bit of a frustration amongst both the professionals, but more importantly, the homeowners who live in these properties, that it has taken us so long as a parliament to get to where we are today. Because from the conversations that I sat round the table, which Mr Whiteman organised, these issues became pretty clear that there was going to have to be something separate in Scotland due to the legal system, and that progress had to be made quickly, and government and politicians would have to be involved in the process, because if we left it simply to mortgage lenders, to surveyors, to owners, it wasn't going to happen. So I am pleased that we've got to where we are today, but I think there is frustration that it has taken us so long to get there. I think having the single assessment is really important, and I think that is really good news for people who are facing a difficult situation. But I also would be interested to know how much work the government have done in private to find out, are there enough surveyors with the experience that is required to do the work that needs to be done? This was again highlighted again a number of years ago, that this will require specific experience which not all surveyors will have. And clearly most of the properties we are talking about are within Edinburgh and Glasgow. So again, it's going to put pressure on the surveyors in those areas to be able to carry out the work. And I do hope that that issue is being addressed. Now, one of the slight difficulties with a framework bill is that there is a lot of detail that will come in secondary legislation. And I would be interested if the Minister, in his summing up, could let us know how quickly will this secondary legislation come forward. Because what we don't want is another delay while regulations are consulted on, are drafted, and then laid before Parliament. And I do hope, and I am confident, that the Minister will have been working on these with his officials already behind the scenes, but whether he could give us some kind of indication of when these will be laid before Parliament, that would be very helpful. Finally, I do want to pick up on the remarks made by Willie Rennie as well. The ultimate success of this bill is not how well we have done in here, it will be how quickly will people be able to get insurance, sell their houses, and most importantly, feel safe to live in the flats and houses that we're talking about. So I wonder, and I know the Minister is an optimist by nature, so I wonder whether he could maybe, again in his closing, give us an indication, when does he think we will be able to get to the point that the houses that we're talking about, the properties we're talking about, will have had the assessment and the work will be done? 2 years, 3 years? Could you give us some indication? Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. And I now call Richard Leonard again around 4 minutes, Mr Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. 1 month from today, June the 14th, will mark 7 years since the Grenfell Tower fire, which claimed the lives of 72 people. That it has taken so long for this Parliament to pass a cladding remediation bill into law is something that we all need to reflect upon. That it has taken so long, 3 years since the Scottish Government received the means through Barnett consequentials to start tackling this crisis in public safety, is something the Government and the new First Minister must reflect upon and act upon as well. Because there has been a failure of political leadership here. The more time we take to carry out remediation, the more we are knowingly exposing people, the people who send us to this Parliament, to extreme risk of harm. So it cannot be right that the UK Government has completed work on almost 800 buildings in England, the Government of Wales on 37 buildings, while in Scotland only one tower block on one site, Glasgow Harbour, has had dangerous cladding removed, and only one block on one site has had any mitigation work carried out at all when there are over 100 buildings in Scotland affected. Let us consider a historical comparison too. On May the 16th, 1968, four people died when one corner of a 23-storey block of flats collapsed after a gas explosion in East London. Ronan Point caught the attention of an entire nation. By August 1968, all large panel system-built blocks over six storeys had been appraised and an inquiry set up. Remedial action was taken straight away. Gas supplies were cut off until all buildings affected were fixed, remedied, remediated. In under 2 years, new building regulations were passed, which became enforceable from 1971. So over half a century later, and a quarter of a century since this Parliament was established, why have we been so slow? The values which should have guided us are straightforward enough. Public safety needs to come before profit. The common good needs to come before private gain. And I would add, we need a bit more common ownership and a bit less corporate ownership of housing. It is a basic human right that people feel safe in their homes. And yet the cold facts tell us something different. 40% of disabled people who lived in Grenfell Tower died that night in 2017. A quarter of all children who lived there died in Grenfell Tower that night. The lives of all those who died were equal, were precious, are still mourned. Justice for them and their families has still not been served. So I finish by saying to the Minister, this bill is not simply about the fabric of buildings. It's about the fabric of our society. It's about disability rights. It's about children's rights. It's about human rights. And I put the Minister on a warning that if the Government does not provide political leadership and provide it with a renewed sense of urgency, then it will be denying the rights of many, including those living day in, day out under the extremes of acute stress. It will be ignoring the unequal burden of those very real risks, and it will be willfully disregarding some fundamental inequalities which still lie at the core of our society. We cannot allow such social irresponsibility, such moral evasion, and such political weakness to deflect us from the urgent and decisive action which we need to take. So Parliament will pass this bill today, but the Government, the Executive, needs to act, and it needs to do so with principle, with purpose, and with potency.
Thank you, Mr Leonard. We now move to closing speeches, and I call first Ariane Burgess, around 4 minutes. Ms Burgess.
Thank you.
The Scottish Government's stated ambition for the bill is to accelerate the progress of the cladding remediation programme. And in closing this debate, I reiterate Scottish Greens' support for this bill as a milestone towards finally resolving Scotland's cladding crisis after years of immense hardship for too many homeowners. Well, let's remember how we got here, and we have heard it to some extent already. The Grenfell Tower tragedy in June 2017 claimed the lives of 72 people when a fire broke out in a flat in the 24-storey residential building in West London. The building had recently had a cladding system installed which comprised combustible foam insulation boards attached to the outside of the concrete structure. These were protected from the weather by aluminium composite materials, ACM panels, the core of which was highly combustible. In the 7 years that have passed since, little meaningful progress has been made to remediate affected buildings here in Scotland. The high-rise inventory has identified 780 high-rise buildings in Scotland containing 46,616 flats. 36 buildings were clad in ACM, 23 of which were clad in the highest risk category 3 panels. Despite this, it is worth noting that the scale of fire risk in Scottish homes is low, and Jim McGonigal of the Institute of Fire Engineers set this out, stating fewer than 1% of fires spread beyond the flat of fire origin. Since Scotland took responsibility for the fire stats, there have been no fatalities beyond the flat of origin. And in the past 10 years, there has been a 57% reduction in the number of fires in flats above 6 storeys. While the risk of fire might be relatively low, the issue of cladding has consumed people's lives, causing long-term worry and stress about the safety of their homes, and is having a financial impact on owners who are unable to sell or remortgage their properties. The skills shortage, as I mentioned before, of qualified fire safety professionals looms as a potential bottleneck, and creative solutions like establishing a fire engineering degree programme in Scotland should be seriously explored. We cannot allow this crucial endeavour to be hamstrung by the lack of trained personnel. Perhaps most critically, open and transparent communication, as other colleagues have mentioned, with impacted residents and owners must become a top priority as we implement this legislation. The years of limited engagement and information blackouts are simply unacceptable for people whose lives and financial futures have been put on indefinite hold. This bill presents progress, but not the final solution. Successful execution of the remediation programme will require ongoing vigilance, creative problem solving, adequate funding and resources, and a true collaborative partnership with those whose lives have been upended by this crisis. If we can finally get this right after such a delay, we will not only make Scotland's homes safer, but also restore peace of mind to thousands of our constituents who have suffered sleepless nights, wondering if their largest investment was safe. They deserve nothing less than our full and undivided commitment to delivering on the promise of this bill. And I will continue to support this legislation and monitor its rollout. The First Minister, when he took office recently, indicated that he wanted people in Scotland to live with a sense of safety. Good communication, especially with people who are living with uncertainty in the homes that are part of this cladding remediation programme, is key to providing that sense of safety. Too many lives have been disrupted for far too long already, and it is time to make this right now.
Thank you. I call on Pam Duncan-Glancy, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to close this debate for Scottish Labour today. Since Grenfell, as we've heard, the Scottish Government has fallen behind the rest of the UK in making buildings safe. In England, the UK Government has completed work on 797 buildings, the Welsh Government 37, and the SNP Government has managed just 2. In the meantime, residents of 103 buildings in Scotland have faced unacceptable delays, were unable to move, unable to get insurance, and most of all, were scared in their own homes. That's why, delayed as it is, we welcome action now and will support the legislation at decision time today. I'd like to begin by paying tribute to those residents and owners whose patience has been admirable, but whose determination that the government take action has been unwavering. They have put up with so much, but have kept going and kept pushing for more to be done. If the bill passes today, it will be because of their resolve. It will also pass in a way that has been improved since stage two because of a more collaborative approach, as colleagues including Miles Briggs, Ariane Burgess and Willie Rennie have noted, where changes to the bill from colleagues across this chamber have been accepted. However, I have to say it was disappointing that the government didn't accept some amendments that I still think could have improved the bill further, including those from my colleague Mark Griffin, that sought to clarify key concepts, including whether the bill should include details on what buildings are made of, and to include a definition of tolerable risk as set out in Stage 1 committee report. Quite basic, and I am disappointed they didn't garner the support of the government today. Turning briefly to the amendments in my own name, listening to the experiences of owners and occupiers and learning from the rights violations in Grenfell that Richard Leonard so passionately spoke of, I worked across party, and I thank members for their support, to get support for provisions that would ensure owners and occupiers of these buildings have a voice. And I'm pleased the government supported that today, and others in the same vein from Miles Briggs and others today. That the threat of a conflict of interest in the development of the single building assessment would be mitigated by the operation of this bill. And again, I welcome the commitments on the record of the Minister today. And crucially, my amendment on disabled people, ensuring that they would have access to an emergency evacuation plan in the event the remediation works are identified in the building, particularly crucial given the fact that 41% of deaths in the Grenfell disaster were disabled people. Often people assume that disabled people will be fine, but they are often left out by default. This makes sure that they'll be considered by design, and that's why the amendments matter. It is indeed a matter of rights. And on this, in the letter the Minister sent to me last week, he said, and I quote, "I accept there are specific considerations that must be explored in the context of the cladding remediation programme." He also said he's committed to ensuring that the needs of all homeowners and residents, including disabled people, are fully considered and addressed, and that this must go beyond evacuation and recognise the need for accessible communications and the provision of person-centred advice and guidance as identified on a building-by-building basis. I'm pleased that my amendment on this passed today, and I welcome the Minister's offer to work together to take it forward. I hope that it will come good through the regulation on this commitment that personal emergency evacuation plans in relation to disabled people who request one will be developed, and he can be assured that I will be here to make sure that he does. I am hopeful that the work we've all done together across the chamber on this bill, on behalf of owners and occupiers of these buildings, means that they'll finally get action and the peace of mind that they deserve. Presiding Officer, we must never forget why we're here. In Grenfell in 2017, 72 people tragically lost their lives, their livelihoods and their loved ones. And Willie Coffey reminded us, of course, that there are tragedies close to home too that drive our need to act. We owe it to all of them and the firefighters that work daily to save our lives. To ensure that nothing like Grenfell ever happens again. I said at stage one of this debate that time is of the essence, and upon the passage of the legislation today, as my colleague Mark Griffin has implored, time will be of the essence once again. That's why comments by Jeremy Balfour and colleagues that we need to move apace must be heeded. It's imperative that the government moves without delay. No stone should be left unturned, no dangerous part of a building should go unfixed. The government must now act quickly, transparently and engagingly in the interests of safety and of the residents, because this is indeed about human rights. Owners and occupiers of these buildings have gone this long without those rights being prioritised or protected. I hope now that this can change and that buildings across the Glasgow region and across Scotland can at last be made safe and rights protected. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm going to start this contribution the way I started my speech at stage one, and that is by remembering what started this all off. And others have said it, but I'll repeat it. When Grenfell Tower in London turned into an inferno in June 2017, killing 72 people, we all became aware of the serious issue of cladding, which 7 years on, 7 years, this bill seeks to address. That it has taken 7 years to get to this point in Scotland is a disgrace.
No.
Yes, I will, yes.
I thank Mr Simpson for taking the intervention, and like him, on behalf of my constituents, I want to see action as quickly as possible. But does he agree with me that one of the many learning points through the process of the last years on this issue is to get to a better place in terms of intergovernmental relations, given that this was an example where you had building standards and certain measures in the control of the Scottish Government and the financial industry, whether that be insurance or mortgages, being controlled by the UK Government? There was not enough dialogue from the UK Government at the beginning of this process. All governments need to do more, but I think that's an important learning point going forward.
Graham Simpson.
Well, I have to say I'm disappointed in Ben McPherson for that contribution. I normally agree with a lot of what Ben McPherson says, but you know, I think to try and seek division on this between governments is really not good enough. Now, in the last session, and, you know, muttering is no good, because these are serious, serious issues. In the last session, I and others were... Well, who is muttering here? If they'd like to stand up, they can do. In the last session... Yes, I'll take an intervention. Can I have extra time, Presiding Officer?
I was merely muttering to myself that I think the member said the opposite of what you have just... what the member has characterised them of him having said.
Graham Simpson.
I'll continue. So, in the last session... I and others were pressing the then Housing Minister, Kevin Stewart, for action. And Jeremy Balfour referred to this, but he seemed more interested in trying to find differences in the way the issue was being tackled here and south of the border. We couldn't get him to ban combustible cladding in Scotland. We couldn't get him to ban combustible cladding in Scotland. Think about that. We have been slower to act here. Now, when I spoke in the Stage 1 debate, I quoted from the committee report, which said that although the Scottish Government has committed to ensuring that all 105 buildings in its remediation programme, and we don't know what these 105 buildings are, by the way, are on a pathway to a single building assessment, by summer 2024, as you know, in England, 42% of buildings had either had work started or completed remediation works. What's happened here? Two buildings. Two buildings. Well, I really am going to have extra time if I take another intervention.
I can allow a little extra time.
OK.
Ben McPherson.
I thank Mr Simpson for taking the intervention, and I know from our work on tenements that he very well understands this point, but the fact that we have a different property law arrangement here in Scotland compared with the freehold system in England has presented challenges. And I think that's an important point to acknowledge and why this bill will make a meaningful difference. However, also, would Graham Simpson agree with me that we need a greater understanding of what a pathway to remediation means in order for constituents to understand the timescales involved?
Graham Simpson.
Well, can I thank Ben McPherson for that intervention? And I would say to Mr McPherson is it should not have taken 7 years for us to get to this point. I think he would agree with me on that, because he and I have worked together very, very well on the issue of tenement maintenance. Members will have received an email from me earlier asking them to back a members' debate on proposals around this. A number of members from different parties have already backed that. So we need to move forward together, and we can move forward together on this very serious issue. Now, the bill, as introduced, was A, rushed, and B, not good enough. Some of us did attempt to improve it at stage two, and we failed. But I have to say the Minister, as I said earlier, did commit to working with some of us ahead of stage three. I said, kind of jokingly at the time, that I would just have to trust him on that, but my trust has been repaid. So we've had amendments from myself, Ms Duncan Glancy and Mr Briggs, which the Minister and his team have helped to craft, and I thank him and them for that. Now, I know you're giving me extra time, Presiding Officer, so I'll just quickly mention a few of the other members. Miles Briggs spelled out the impact on residents of all this. Mark Griffin, he mentioned fires in Milan and Valencia, and just the general dangers of cladding. I was struck by a comment from Ariane Burgess, who said we should have no more excuses. It's time for action. And Ariane Burgess is absolutely right. Presiding Officer, the bill isn't perfect, but it's better than it was. At its heart, it gives ministers the power to arrange remediation work, which has been identified in that single building assessment report as being needed to eliminate or mitigate risks to human life that are created or exacerbated by an external wall cladding system. Now, whether that involves the original developers or whether they've gone bust or disappeared doesn't matter, because the work needs to be done. We have to get rid of all dangerous cladding. The effects of fire can at the worst be tragic, as we saw at Grenfell, but they can also be life-changing. So time will tell if this bill will help to get dangerous cladding removed, but I'll back it in order that we give it the chance to do so.
Thank you, and I now call on Paul McLennan to wind up to 10 past five, Minister. Thank you.
How long, Presiding Officer? Just
to 5:10.
Right, OK, no problem. Presiding Officer, thank you very much, and can I first of all thank the Bill team for their help and guidance today, and to the wider Cladding team. They've been fantastic to help to myself, so my personal thanks to them. I'm also grateful to members for their contributions for this afternoon's debate, which I'll touch on in a little second. Today, I think, has been the case throughout the bill process. Discussion has been highly constructive. I know that members on all sides of this chamber are committed to safeguarding homeowners and residents from the dangers posed by unsafe cladding, and that has been evident in the cooperation and collaboration that has helped shape this bill. And I want that to continue, and I really genuinely mean that. And I give my commitment to working together on the points that we've raised in the discussion today and points that are still outstanding as we move forward in the remediation programme. So today has explored a number of issues, and as I said before, my door's open to discuss that. I want to make some specific thanks. I mentioned before around about COCAB and Pam Duncan Clancy, but there's others I want to help as well. Miles, obviously, for his work in terms of that. Graham, for his collaboration as well. My apologies, Miles Briggs and Graham Simpson, in terms of that, and also in terms of that. Ariane Burgess as well, the convener, obviously, in the work that she's carried out. Pam Duncan Clancy, as I said, and Ben McPherson, who I've met on a couple of occasions with his residents. So my special thanks to Ben. Deirdre Brock, who was also involved in that. And again, I mentioned special thanks to COCAB Stewart for the work that she's carried out. I want to touch on some of the points that were raised during the debate, and I'll come on to Miles Briggs first of all. I think the issue around about orphan buildings, I'm happy to take that up with you. I think we gave that commitment that wouldn't be lower down the rung, if you like, in terms of that, but happy to discuss that with you. The building safety issues, I think, has been raised by a number of people, and I think I'm happy to either engage with people individually on that point or again through the committee, and again, I'm happy to liaise on that, and I think that's important. I think Mark Griffin touched on a number of things, obviously talked about the legislation. The progress has to quicken, and I think I've acknowledged that we do have to do that. I think the bill is the first stage in terms of that. In terms of the secondary legislation, I think one of the key things I kind of said at the start was almost trying to be held to account, so we're reporting back, and happy again to either meet with yourself on our regular meetings or through the committee again. So you've got my commitment to meet with you regarding how we develop secondary legislation and timescales around about that, so happy to continue discussing these with you. I think the point that Ariane Burgess made was very important around about the skills issues. We have had meetings with building safety and fire safety issues colleagues at the moment. Now, at the moment, they think they have the capacity to deal with that, but we need to keep an eye on that, and I think that's a very valid point that Ariane Burgess makes in terms of that. In terms of the communication process that Willie Rennie mentioned, I think that's very important. I think we touched that during the debate around about how important residents know about the process at the start of the process, what like the timescales are. And I think one of the key things I worked on, for example, with Graham Simpson was around about the reporting process. I need to be held to account in that, and I think that's incredibly important in that. I'm happy to work with them in terms of looking at deadlines and so on. And I think Jeremy Balfour touched on that as well. Willie Coffey touched on about the case in Irvine, as did the historic case that obviously Richard Leonard talked about as well. And I'm going to come on to the points that he made, and that was a number of years ago, so we have to learn from that, and also around about the wider consideration of building safety. Jeremy Balfour touched around about the start of the process. I wouldn't say we're quite at the start of the process, but this allows us to quicken the pace, and I think that's really important in terms of that. He also mentioned around about, obviously, the surveyors and fire engineers
which I think is incredibly important, and also raised about the secondary legislation, which again I'm happy to discuss with him or through a committee. Richard Leonard touched on obviously some of the historic cases going back a number of years, and you hit the nail on the head for me when you mentioned it. We can talk about this in here, we can talk about this, but what you said, it's a basic right to have a safe home, and that has to guide us all in terms of that, and it certainly will in regards to me. So that's something that's going to stick with me in terms of the debate this afternoon. Pam Duncan Clancy obviously mentioned about the number of buildings, and continue to work with Pam very closely on that issue going forward. And I think Ben McPherson made a point obviously around about collaboration, particularly around about looking at mortgages and insurance and so on. I'll continue to work collaboratively with the UK Government on that matter. We've raised it before, we'll continue to raise it again. So, President Officer, I'm grateful to all members who've contributed to the progress of the bill in the weeks and months leading up today, and to the broad support for it from across the chamber. I know that as Parliament, and the most important people in this are residents, and obviously the broader owners and stakeholders want to see an increase in the pace of cladding remediation in Scotland. I want to see that. I desperately want to see that. President Officer, I believe that this bill provides a strong foundation on which to accelerate the operational delivery of our cladding remediation programme and to deliver for those affected by unsafe cladding in our communities and constituencies. I commend the motion in my name, and I very much hope that members will vote for it tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill at Stage 3. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 13216 on committee membership. And I ask Jamie Hepburn, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, and there are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 13190 in the name of Paul McLennan on Housing Cladding Remediation Scotland Bill be agreed. And as this is a motion to pass the bill at stage three, the question must be decided by division, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.